Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison for GI. Thank you so much for joining us. It is Monday evening. We are doing the thing that we do every Monday evening, which is chat about the guitar. Thanks for joining us. I really appreciate you guys coming along and being part of these streams. It's becoming a real highlight in my week. I love hanging out with you guys, talking about all this good stuff. Today, of course, we are continuing our series on first steps into fusion. We've got some more strategies for navigating chord changes. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the stylistic elements too. We will get to that, but in the meantime, let's check in with the chat. Let's see how you guys are getting on. You'll have to excuse me, I have pretty much just rushed in and sat down to play the guitar today, so I'm still warming up as we go, so we may have some slightly hairy notes, but hey, what else is new? If you're just joining us, let us know where you're watching from. We would love to hear from you guys. Drop us a message in the chat. Of course, the best ways that you can support this stream, if it's something you're getting use out of, something you're interested in supporting, you can do it for free in a variety of ways. You can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching. It's a heart on Facebook, or if you're watching us on YouTube, give us a thumbs up for the algorithm. Comments really help too. And of course, you can share the stream with your guitar playing friends, because we want to get this out to as many guitar players as possible. We think it's pretty good, so we'd like to get it out to as many players as we can. So let's just check in with the stream. Let's see who we have, old friends and new. Marcine was here 5 minutes before the start. He says, hi Nick, hi guys. Marcine, it's great to have you. Matt has excused me from butchering his username as ever. Matt, thank you very much. Thanks for having us. Honkstains, okay, cool. Great username, says, excited, man. It's great to have you on board. Thanks for joining us. Mark McNish says, hey Nick, he's in need of some motivation. Well, motivation I have for you, Mark, because we're gonna hopefully get you playing some interesting new stuff for the day. I'm just gonna shake out my wet hair as we go. It's been a bit of a mad rush today. It's been rushing around like a crazy person, but I'm happy that I'm here with you guys. So anyway, who else do we have? Matt Brunette says, evening everyone. Hi Nick, Matt, it's great to have you on board. Our friend Tin Man Tin is in the stream. Chris Davies, a longtime friend of the GI YouTube channel. Chris, it's lovely to have you on board. Honkstains says, how many hours a day do you practice, Nick? I'm pretty sure I don't play Nelly enough. You know what? Let's readdress this in the Q&A later on. So listen, if you guys do have questions, right, drop them in the comments and I'll answer them in the Q&A. We're going to be doing a live Q&A like we always do at the back end of this stream, so I'll address that question a bit later on. It's Honkstains. I thought it said Honkstains. Man, I need to update my glasses. Honkstains says, instantly, Honkstains would be a great name for a blues band though, wouldn't it? Like that. That real kind of like honky sound. We are the Honkstains. I could 100% see that. Honkstains. Hank, I do apologize. I butcher usernames on this channel all of the time. So I'll answer that question a little bit later on. Anyway, who else do we have? Bobby T, 1992, says, another free lesson full of goodness. Fingers crossed. I will try my best for you. What's the PRS, says John Smith, looks vintage. Oh, well, I guess it is. It's 2002. This is a 2002 Custom 22. This is my number one guitar. So this is the guitar I've had. Of all my guitars, I've had this the longest. It's one of the oldest, and I absolutely love it. I don't use it as much as some of my others, like, anymore, but it's still my number one, if that makes sense. In my head, it's still my number one, but I have other guitars that'll take out more often because maybe they have a greater variety of tones, or maybe they're a little less noisy. Not that these pickups are super noisy, but they're only partially potted, so there are some stages where I can't use these pickups, for example, and my Fluence loaded guitars are like super noiseless. So yeah, a few occasions when I won't take this out. Doug Ward says, good afternoon, everyone. I assume that, Doug, you're watching us from the United States. Thank you very much for joining us. Baptiste says, Nick, how you doing? How are you? I'm doing great, my man. Thank you very much. Thank you very kindly. Who else do we have? James says, hi from Glasgow. Are PRS SEs any good? Yes, indeed they are. They're fabulous guitars. Fabulous, fabulous guitars. Let's see who else we have. Guy Vigava says, good right hand technique, no doubt. I could not possibly comment. Anyway, who else do we have? Got to change my name now, says Hank. Hank, really sorry. Wow, okay. Alexander Radakovich says, tell me if I got that right. I really hope I got that right. Says, try to pronounce this. I really hope I got that right. Alexander Radakovich, is that right? Please tell me it is. Anyway, listen, we're going to get into the meat of the stream. Of course, another way that you can support these streams, if that's something you'd like to do, is you can check out GI Plus. GI Plus is the logo is way up here. It is, of course, the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine. The URL is here. You can check that out at the GI website. It's the exclusive lesson platform from GI, where you'll find lessons from myself, Tom Quayle, Sam Bell, Phil Short, Chris Buck, Andy James, Andy Wood, Rick Graham, Giorgio Cerci, Michael Caswell, like you name it, right? If somebody's taught for GI, they are there. We're adding new stuff all the time. We've got some slide content coming very soon from a very cool new contributor who I will introduce you guys to at a certain point. Six String Jim says, is there an age limit to start learning fusion? Asking for a friend. I guess in the same way there's an age limit for eating chilies. Some kids really get into it. Some kids, not so much. You'll just have to develop a taste for it. If you develop a taste for fusion, that's the correct age for learning fusion, I think, personally. Anyway, let's get into it. So, in a previous stream, let's go to the close-up cam. In a previous stream last week, we talked about strategies for playing over minor chords. We talked about the idea that your core place to start, if you're playing over a minor chord, in a fusion context is Dorian. So Dorian, we could play over our YouTube Fusion style backing track, which is available on the GI YouTube channel. If you're not subscribed, please do so, because we get all these great backing tracks, like the one I was playing in the intro. Our YouTube Fusion style backing track is this one. Now, this one is modulating Dorian sound, or modulating minor chords. So what we get is an A minor, over which we play a Dorian. The next one we have is C minor, which I'm playing like this, of which we play C Dorian. Then over the next one we have D minor, of which we play D Dorian. And then lastly we have F minor, of which we play F Dorian. So let me throw that out there, and I'm going to talk you through these as we go, just a quick recap, and then we'll talk about some of the chord types. Okay, A Dorian, here we go. Dorian, coming up to D Dorian here, F Dorian, back to A Dorian, and so on and so forth. Now, what you may have noticed, that we'd hopefully noticed with this, is what I was trying to do there is I was trying to take a musical idea and carry it over these changes. So rather than just playing something in the appropriate minor scale and then stopping, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to play something that I can thread through into our new tonality. This is an idea that we might call threading an idea through the changes. And I've heard Tom Quayle talk about it like this. I think it's a term that makes sense. I'm not deeply immersed in the jazz world, so I'm guessing it's probably come from there. But hey, you know, I'm willing to be informed if you guys know where that terminology comes from. I've just heard Tom use it, and Tom is my go-to for all things fusion. So let's just try that again. So I'm going to show you what I'm trying not to do. And this is just a general principle to bear in mind for the rest of this lesson. So what I'm trying not to do is play an idea and then stop before the next chord, where I get and then stop again. Changes a little obvious. So what I might try and do is I might try and play ideas that go between our two chords, something like this. and so on. Got very carried away there and kept on playing. So that threading through the changes, something that we're going to be talking about as we go a little bit further with this stream. So that's a Dorian thing. We also talked about the idea of playing some outside type tonalities. Now, some outside type tonalities might be things like melodic minor in lieu of Dorian. That actually works really surprisingly well. It actually works really well in a rock context too. If we throw on a Dorian style Led Zeppelin style backing track that I've been using quite a lot of, I'm a big fan of this track. I made it, so I guess that's probably slightly egotistical of me to say, but I think it came out pretty well. And of course, I didn't make the tune it was based on. So, you know, just based on one of my favorite Zeppelin tracks. Anyway, so what we might do here is we might use the idea of melodic minor as something that's a little like Dorian. It's Dorian-esque because it has the same... I just need to take a moment here, by the way. Sorry, we've just popped this in the comments, by the way. In the coming weeks, we'll bring you some very special live stream lessons, folks, and the styles and techniques of some guitar lessons. Who would you like us to cover? Drop that in the comments because I'd love to know. But Matt Burnett has said Jason Becker. Matt, you don't want very much, do you? I love you, but man, okay, right. Setting the bar really high right from the offset. Hey, who knows? Maybe we'll have a go. But anyway, so if I take this idea of playing my Zeppelin style backing track, which is ostensibly Dorian, E Dorian in this case, and if I play E Dorian like here, repeated downstrokes there, but that's a stylistic thing. Yeah, if I take the idea of my playing E Dorian, and then I take all of my E Dorian phrases, I take all the D notes and sharpen them, I get E melodic minor, which is kind of like Dorian. Noodling away now, but you get what I'm going at with this one. It sounds like Dorian, but just a little bit like sour in an interesting way. This is incidentally a device that you hear guys who have a little bit of grounding in fusion but aren't really like ostensibly fusion players like myself doing quite a lot. A really big proponent of this is Ian Thornley from Big Wreck. If you guys don't know Ian Thornley, you gotta check out Ian Thornley. He's one of my favorite guitar players, one of my favorite bands. I love Big Wreck. But yeah, he'll do this thing all the time where he'll just drop melodic minor in over a minor chord because it sounds kind of interesting and, you know, like kind of, I don't know, I guess spicy in an interesting way. We also talked about the idea of using chromaticism and using the idea of chromatic passing tones as a spice that you can throw into your playing. So very quickly on the same backtrack, let me show you what I'm talking about. Here we go. So let's say this is Dorian. Sounds cool, but if we start to throw in some notes that aren't in the Dorian scale, like this one right here, we get some really interesting results. That's that chromaticism thing that we talked about. So listen, I just want to point out at this point, by the way, if you're having trouble following these ideas, don't sweat it, because we have a whole stream on this last week where you can go back and catch this. This is just a quick recap. So listen, if you're having an issue with that, then, you know what I've just realized? I'm playing this stuff and the Led Zeppelin backing track is not coming out with the correct output on my interface. So you guys can't even hear that. Let me just do that again real quick. I'll show you what I'm doing. So very quickly, you got a whole bunch of me like playing away, doing a whole bunch of nothing. But let's very quickly recap. So this is E. Dorian. Hopefully you can hear that now. This is Zeppelin style backing track. Just let me know in the comments if you can hear this, by the way. If you can hear the track, I'll play on. So Dorian. Let's go to melodic minor. Let's throw in some chromatic notes like this. And apologize for some blues. So there you go. Backing track issues aside, hopefully you guys can see what's going on there. So let's address some of the chord types. Now, the other two real main, or rather three main chord types that we need to talk about are what we do with dominant chords, what we do with functional dominant chords, which is a different thing entirely, and also what we do with major chords. So let's start with major chords. Major chords are real simple. When you come across a major chord in a fusion context, or when you come across a major chord that doesn't seem to fit with other chords in a rock or blues or pop or otherwise context, you play Lydian as your go-to. It's the reason I played our Lydian backing track in the intro. So if you want a bit of time shedding your Lydian, you want a bit of woodshed, your Lydian playing. Sorry, I thought it was a push-pull on this guitar and there's not, and I've just pulled the lampshade knob off and then got very concerned that I'd broken my guitar live on stream, but I haven't, it's fine. Anyway, yeah, if you want a bit of practice playing Lydian stuff, you can check out the latest GI backing track, which is an 80s Lydian style backing track. It's a real great way to practice your Lydian phrasing. So yeah, let's talk about what we do with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to another Lydian style backing track. This is the Joe Satriani style backing track that we put up recently. Now, this is not ostensibly fusion, but it's a good way to practice Lydian stuff. So let me show you what's going on here, right? We have parallel Lydian chords, starting with an F major chord, which is going to give us some Lydian. This is really Lydian, but if it wasn't terribly Lydian, it would still work. Next up, we have C major. And that is going to give us another Lydian sound. There's our Lydian C major thing going on. Next up is going to be an F major. Again, we'll play Lydian over this. So it's coming up here, F right here. And over this, we play F Lydian. And then over this next one right here, that is going to be a D major. And we're going to play D Lydian over this. So it's coming up right here. This is another great way to practice playing the changes over these chords. So I'll shout them out as we go. We'll do the same demonstration we did with Dorian earlier on, because this doesn't take a whole lot of our time. We're going to just get through this pretty quickly. So here's A Lydian. We can use those same souring techniques as well to play like chromatic ideas. Here's C Lydian. Going to F Lydian. Going to D Lydian. And away we go. So you guys get the gist. Now, there is one unique feature about Lydian, which I think is kind of interesting as pertains to the way it sounds and playing it through changes. And it might change the way you think about your Lydian playing just a little bit. This is something you can also port into Dorian in an interesting way, but it's not quite the same. So Lydian has this sharp four note, which everybody knows as the character note. So the sharp four in the key of A, for example, would be a D sharp note, which is something like this. Interestingly enough, there's one note in Lydian that doesn't sound that great, to be completely honest. Doesn't sound that great. And the bit that doesn't sound that great, or the note that doesn't sound that great, is the root, which is a little strange. So the A over A Lydian doesn't sound terribly cool, and likewise, C over C Lydian doesn't sound terribly cool. So if we were to take the idea of playing a Lydian and just excluding the root for a moment, let's have a look at what happens. Let's see what we get. So if we take the idea of playing A Lydian, for argument's sake, and we miss out the A, well, let's see what we have. So we have B, C sharp, D sharp, right here. So again, B, C sharp, D sharp, E, F sharp, G sharp, and then we don't have an A. So we get this. Now that together spells out C sharp minor pentatonic with the addition of a 9. So what you can do, and this is a slightly more advanced way of looking at this, is you can play as a substitute for Lydian, you can play a minor pentatonic up a major third or up two tones, with the option of dropping a 9 in there. And that is going to give you a scale that is ostensibly Lydian, but doesn't include that root that we don't particularly like the sound of. It sounds maybe a bit like kind of on the nose, let's say. And this is one of my favorite ways of thinking about Lydian, because I come from being like a rock and metal player. So I always think of Lydian as like the C chord in an E minor C type progression. And I kind of think in these terms anyway. So what I might do is over this chord progression right here, I might play over my A Lydian. I might play C sharp minor pentatonic, which is again up major third, with the option to drop in a 9. We've covered this in a previous stream, by the way. If you want to get into this idea of pentatonics in the modes, we have streams on that that are available to view on the GI YouTube channel. Over the C, that would give me an E minor pentatonic, with the option to drop in a 9. Over the F, that would give me an A minor pentatonic, with the option to drop in the 9. And then over the D Lydian, it would give me F sharp minor pentatonic. Let me just phrase with those and we'll see what we get. Now again, this is kind of a rock track rather than a fusion track, but the principle stands. So let me show you what I'm talking about here, right? Your C sharp minor pentatonic. And here's E minor pentatonic. And over our F Lydian, here's A minor pentatonic. And then F sharp minor pentatonic over this. Let's thread some ideas using this, this pentatonic idea. Very lost there at the end. Just a little distracted, one of my fingers fell off. But you guys get the idea, right? So this pentatonic thing for Lydian, that's actually a really cool trick. And there are other ways that we can do this with pentatonic superimposition. Maybe we'll talk about that another time. But let's get into the world of dominant chords, because there are some interesting things we can do with dominant chords that just sort of crop up out of nowhere. And there are also some interesting things we can do with functional dominant chords. And we'll explain the difference between the two as we go. Also, incidentally, if you're wondering how this Lydian thing fits in your rock playing, let me show you this. This is the 87 Ballad. It's a Whitesnake style backing track. It's one of the ones that somebody stole and put his own playing over and then tried to get us copyright struck. Again, available on the GI YouTube channel. This is in E minor, but there's an F chord in there. So an F major chord. We play F Lydian over the F major chord, and you are home safe. You get this. Let's take a little further back. Okay, E minor. Comes. F Lydian. You're home safe. So over that F major chord, we play F Lydian. So it spills over into your rock playing. Now, there are occasions where you'll do the same with dominant chords. So let's talk about the idea of playing over like a dominant chord that's not really like it's not really a dominant chord that has a function in that it doesn't go to a one chord. Now, what I mean by this, functional dominance, very quickly. A functional dominance is the sort of thing you hear at the end of a 12-bar blues. So you might get something like this, where you get... That is a five chord. It goes to a one chord. You might hear it in a 2-5-1, so you might hear something like this. You might hear it in minor 2-5-1, you might hear something like that. Either way, that a functional dominant chord is a dominant chord that resolves somewhere. So it resolves to usually a chord a fifth down or a fourth up, same thing. Over this, we have very specific ways that we approach it because functional dominant chords can generally be altered, which we'll get to. This also applies to you blues players out there. But non-functional dominant chords, so dominant chords that aren't necessarily like related to the key, I'm just making sure I have a backing track that fits this. We would generally play mixed Lydian over this. So let me give you an example. So mixed Lydian, Blue Sunland's been using mixed Lydian, by the way. Just throwing out there, been using mixed Lydian. Mixed Lydian's a great scale, right? It is essentially, for those who don't know, you might think about it as a... Ooh, there's a few ways you can skin a cat with this one. You can think about it as a major pentatonic with a flat 7 and 4. That can work. So we can get this to this. Or you can think about it as a Dorian scale with the thirds raised. Which comes from a minor pentatonic. So it's a minor pentatonic with a blues bend. But you can fret it if you want. With the usual alterations we make to turn a minor pentatonic into Dorian. I have this theory that there are two mixed Lydians, depending upon where you bring them from, but that's just a pet theory, that's pure conjecture. But this idea that there is essentially a minor pentatonic and a major pentatonic derived mixed Lydian and you play them in two different ways, that's just my little thoughts on the subject. But let me show you what I'm talking about with this. So we're going to go to our Top Gun ballad, and I'm going to find the verse. So the verse has a really interesting chord progression. It's in B minor. Just find this for you. So right here, we're gonna get a B minor chord. And our B minor chord is gonna go to G minor, G major even. So we're still in B minor. And then we're gonna get a moment where we go to an E dominant chord. Where we go here. Now, that in and of itself is quite interesting because that is not a chord that is in the key of A minor, so we have to treat it somewhat differently. We would treat this, generally speaking, with an E mixed Lydian. Allow me to show you. So here's some B minor. We'll do a little more on dominant chords for real another time, but I want to do some functional dominant stuff today. So here comes B minor. Coming up to that E dominant, where I'm going to play E mixed Lydian. never blink and you'll miss a thing. So we'll do another pass. Here it comes, E-Mix Lydian. So if you find those chord progressions, we just have a random dominant chord crop up out of nowhere. You can do some real interesting stuff with mixed Lydian now. There are a few other scales you can play. Lydian dominant works really well for this stuff too. So Lydian dominant in this context, maybe a little bit too fusiony, but let's try it. So Lydian dominant, you might think about this, if you're familiar with mixed Lydian, you could think about this as a mixed Lydian scale with a raised fourth. Lydian dominant scale, that works. You could also think about this, just cracking my knee for a second there, apologies. You could also think about it as a melodic minor. You could think about it as the fourth mode of melodic minor, if that's something you wanted to do, if you're into that parental thinking. Personally, I find it's more useful just to think about it as its own thing and just learn it as its own formula. So what we'd get would be 1, 2, 3, sharp 4, 5, 6, flat 7. One more time, 1, 2, 3, sharp 4, 5, 6, flat 7. Interesting. One sharp and one flat, but that's melodic minor for you folks. So let me show you what I'm doing there. So same place. And when it comes to the E dominant, I'm going to play E melodic minor. Oh, sorry, E Lydian dominant, which is derived from B melodic minor. So what we get is this. Okay, got it? All just B minor at the time for the moment. Here comes E, a Lydian dominant. With a very clumsy resolution. I'll try that again. Here it comes. So right away, that's got a real kind of like fusion sort of vibe about it that I really like. Let's just drop that into a blues very quickly, because you can play this stuff with blues too. So what I'll do here is I'm going to treat the 4 chord. We're going to be in the key of A. I'll treat the 4 chord with Lydian dominant. So Lydian dominant, I'm going to play some blues stuff, and then I'm going to play Lydian dominant, we're in the key of A, over the D chords, which you'll hear in this 12 bar real quick. I'll shout them out. Here's A. Here it comes. You hear that? I'll try it one more time. Once again. Here it comes. Lydian dominant. Because we're playing blues, we apologize for it with some blues phrasing. So you guys can hear how that works. Lydian dominant is a really cool strategy for dominant chords that don't resolve. But what about dominant chords that do resolve? So I'm going to open this up to the comments, and I want to know what you guys want to do over this. So what would you do over a chord progression like this? I'm going to throw the Richie Kotzen style backing track on. Again, you'll find this in the GI backing track playlist, which you can find right here. So we're going to throw the Richie Kotzen style backing track on, which has 4 chords in it. It's going to be C minor, and then A flat major 7. So we have C Dorian if you want it, A flat Lydian, F sharp minor, which would be F sharp Dorian, or rather F Dorian, all to the key of C primarily at this point. And then we have a G7 altered. Now I want to know what you're going to play over this G7 altered chord. So you let me know in the comments what you would play over this G7 altered. I'm going to put the chord progression on, put the back track on. I'll play over the top. You let me know what strategy that you would use for this G7 altered. Let's try. Here we go. Let's have a little play. Okay. There's the F sharp minor. And there's the G7 altered. Again. comes. So. This is just a vamp on C sharp minor. It's because it's Dorian on my triumelodic minor. Guys can hear there is you can hear the chord changing, you can hear how I'm addressing it. We've got some really great suggestions on here, we're gonna pour through them real quick. So Mike with an I, yeah, there you go. Mike Jazz says altered, absolutely correct. Yeah, altered scale has a number of pseudonyms, and most of you guys who've commented have hit the nail on the head here. So Hank Stain says A flat melodic minor, start on the G, and it's called G altered. Yeah, you can call it G superlocrine, you can call it G altered. We would basically play over this instance. A real solid strategy would be to play the A flat melodic minor, starting on G, finishing on G, gives us this sound. So A flat melodic minor, let's say for example I started it here. You guys can hear how that's slipping in and out. So that's an interesting way of doing things. We've got a bunch of other cool suggestions too. So superlocrine, really good shout. What's interesting is everybody's reaching for big scales here, but that's okay. We'll kind of hit that, we'll approach that as we go. Another one interesting here, C minor and half whole diminished over the G7 altered. Very interesting. Yeah, half whole diminished is a really fine choice. So half whole diminished will work over this particular chord because we haven't necessarily set out any of the alterations that are in it. So it's a dominant chord. If it's just the dominant chord, you can play half whole diminished and it will fly. So you could play G half whole diminished or any of the half whole diminished scales that are derived from there. So you might visualize it as G or B flat, or you could visualize it as D flat or even E half whole diminished, and that would work too. So that might sound something like this real quick. Missed it there. I went super lockering out of instinct. All those are going to work. So that's a really cool choice. What else do we have? Mike Jazz says Mixo flat 9, flat 13. Interesting choice. Okay, so what would that give us? I would probably express, an interesting way of referring to that, I would probably express that as Phrygian dominant. Unless I've missed something. I don't think I have. Yeah, I'll probably call that Phrygian dominant. So I'll call it G Phrygian dominant because I'm a rock guy and we play Phrygian dominant all of the time. It's the Malmsteen scale.
Thank you.
You know, it's been such a long time since I did that Malmsteen thing. I think I've forgotten how to do it, but you get the idea. So yeah, Phrygian dominant is actually a really good choice too, or mixo flat 9, flat 13, if that's a way you want to refer to it. So a little baffled by that, I must be honest. I'm like, hey, there's a cool scale in the comments. What's this? It just shows there's a million ways to skin a cat with the namings of these things. So yeah, you can absolutely play Phrygian dominant. And in this case, you play it from G. You could actually think about that, in this case, as playing C harmonic minor. That would kind of work. It's a very rockist approach to play C harmonic minor over that altered dominant. But it is a cool sound. It does work, right? Now, here's an interesting thing. Here we go. I was amazed to discover that Phrygian dominant is the fifth of harmonic minor, I think. It is, yeah, absolutely is. I mean, here's an interesting thing. You can coincidentally find it if you start it, if you start the harmonic minor from the fifth, but that doesn't mean that that's what it is. I mean, you find it there. It absolutely is that, but that doesn't mean that's where it's from. And I feel like this is something where people kind of miss themselves. We've got one more great suggestion I want to pick on. Marcin has said something diminished, by the way, and we did the half whole diminished. That's absolutely going to work. Mike Jazz says whole tone. Yeah, whole tone is a great shout. There's two ways you can play whole tone, in my opinion, because the whole tone scale, the interesting way it works is you essentially have just repeating semitones. So you have two whole tone scales, and there are only two. Really, you have like C whole tone and D flat whole tone, and then as soon as you get to a D, you're actually playing C whole tone again, and so on. So what you would do is you could play whole tone from the tonic, which would actually work really well. Or you could play it from a semitone above, which would also work in a really interesting kind of way. It might sound a little bit spicy, but... let's actually try playing that. Let's throw a whole tone in. So we're going to play a whole tone starting on the tonic. That's going to work because we haven't established the alterations to our chord. Let's play it up a tone. Pretty spicy. I would suggest that in this instance, my experience is that, play the whole tone from the tonic, that works. Play it from the G, play it from somewhere else, yeah, not so much. Hank Staines has said G superlocrian, absolutely. G superlocrian, Hank, I'm sure you know this already, but that is literally A flat melodic minor with emphasis on the Gs. That's it. So yeah, you're absolutely right. So some really cool strategy for that. What's quite interesting is that everybody's reaching for big sounds for this. It can be quite cool sometimes just to reach for smaller sounds or reach for smaller pools of notes. A really cool strategy is to play a minor 7 flat 5 arpeggio, which would be this one. If you play that from a tone down, from the G in this instance, you can get the same kind of noise. But without quite so much tone density. And just to clear this up, Matt Brunetta said, so just so I'm clear with what's happening, we're changing the scales based on the chord. That is exactly what we're doing. And we're changing the scale based on the chord we're playing over. And that is the essence, in my opinion, at least, of fusion. Because we're playing in fusion, right? We're taking our first steps into fusion. Fusion is, among other things, it's a stylistic thing, but it's also essentially the art of playing through chord changes that don't necessarily relate to each other, but with a rock attitude and a rock sound and a rock kind of delivery. If you take that rock delivery away, you just have jazz, which is fine. Nothing wrong with that. But the fusion thing is essentially the vocabulary of, well, started at least with the idea of jazz vocabulary with a rock attitude. And that's why fusion specifically refers to a fusion of these two genres and not say, like reggae and trip hop. That's also a fusion. And you get fusion house music too, but that's a different thing. Not the same deal. So anyway, on we go. So there's lots and lots of scales. We've got a bunch of questions about this, but I feel like we've captured the essence of this strategy of playing over changes. So we've ticked that box, which means the next thing we can approach, which we'll do in our next stream, these streams just go on forever, so we have to kind of, you know, extend them out. We will do one more. Our next stream, we'll cover some more of the stylistic elements of fusion, which are it's all sorts of stuff. So it's things like your vibrato and things like the articulations that you play, this slidey thing that became a cliche, the sound, the timing, the time feel, etc., etc., etc. We'll address that in a future stream, because we really need to tick this chord changes box so everybody knows what kind of side we're on here. But I guess another thing with this is when a lot of people say they want to get into fusion, they want to be able to play rock stuff with a bit of a fusion attitude. So let me just give you a quick hack for that real quick. Let's say, for example, we're going back to our Led Zeppelin style jam. Probably, in my estimation, the easiest way to sound immediately fusion, I think, is to pick your scale notes derived from the pentatonic scale that we talked about. So in this instance, we're playing E Dorian, derived from our E minor pentatonic scale. And instead of playing notes like this and this, we're talking about third and the sixth as passing tones, land on them. Be brave, land on these notes that sound a little bit unusual. Here, but you get the idea, right? That's an interesting way to sound immediately fusion. You throw some of that in, some chromaticism, some scales that are closely related to what you're playing but a little sour depending upon the chord that you're playing over, remembering again that minor chords can withstand a little more tension than major chords can, dominant chords can withstand a lot of tension, and alter dominant chords can withstand all of the tension, so much tension because they're tense because of themselves. Do that and you will have a little bit of a foot into the door of fusion guitar playing. So listen, we are 50 minutes in and we're only supposed to do an hour, so we may end up spilling over by about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, but we are going to go to the Q&A. But before we do, I'd like your questions. Drop them in the comments. We've got some really great questions in already, but I want to know what you guys want to know, so drop your questions in the comments. We'll do the Q&A, but first I want to show you this. This is, of course, GI+. Best way you can support this stream is by checking out GI+. Looks like this. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI+, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI+ today. So there you go, guys. That's GI Plus. We are back with the live Q&A. Got some great questions. So let's get stuck straight in with them. If you've got any more questions, drop them down below. I will be happy to answer them. Let's start with a few that are going to be easy to answer, hopefully. Here we go. Let me just quickly dig in at the very top because I promised I would answer this one too. How many hours a day do you practice slash play, Nick? I'm sure I don't play nearly enough. Okay, so let's start with how much time I spend practicing, because this is important, right? So practicing, I won't do more than 2 hours in a day as a rule of thumb, and I won't do more than an hour's worth of practice at a given time. The reason for this is the way skill acquisition works, we've talked about this before on the stream, the way skill acquisition works is you essentially apply a stimulus to the system, which is you, and you then need to give that some time to take. So in my opinion, and this is backed up by research too, in my opinion, an hour's worth of really concentrated practice is a kind of a sweet spot. It's a nice amount of time to be practicing, really working on stuff, working on skill development, working on getting some new sounds into your fingers and into your ears and whatnot, all that good stuff. And then it's good to take some time away and to rest. I feel like personally 2 hours is enough. In terms of how many hours a day I play, it depends what I'm doing on a given day. So it can be as much as 8 hours if I'm filming videos, and then I'll try and get my practice around that. If I'm doing a day where I'm playing loads, I probably won't practice more than 1 hour for the day. If I'm gigging, that's gigs, you guys know how that works. If I got rehearsals, you know, they can be again up to like 5-6 hours in a day. I'll scale my practice depending upon what I have going on through the day, but I try not to actually practice more than 2 hours, and there'll be two individual 1 hour sessions. Sometimes they're shorter than 1 hour, sometimes they're 30 minutes. I feel like you can get a lot of damage done in 30 minutes, especially from the perspective of actually getting better and skill acquisition. So hopefully that answers your question. I promised I would answer that. So, here we go. Let's do some more quick questions that we can answer. What type of slide do you use, Nick? Says Blue Sumlin. I use this guy. This is a rock slide. Medium glass. No, sorry, small glass. Small glass. I have a few of the rock slide slides. Just going to reach forward and grab them because I like them all for different reasons. This is small rock slide in stainless steel. Very interesting. They don't make them anymore, I don't think, but they'll do limited runs. This is not an Ariel Posen slide. This is a small ball tip. The Ariel Posen slide is slightly longer, and I didn't really like that. I like that kind of short slide thing. I really like this one because I can fret with it. So I can fret with just the tip of it, which is pretty cool. But it is a little heavy, so it doesn't work terribly well all the time, unless I'm really on the ball. It doesn't work terribly well with guitars with a standard, fairly low action. Like that. Got to be really on the ball for that stuff, whereas the glass slide easily fly around. Fly with that. So yeah, that's the type of slide I use. Can you give us a preview of the slider cliche that will be covered in the next stream? I'm curious and impatient. I absolutely can. It's this. This is the slider cliche. Now, I know this as the George Lynch vibrato. This is kind of maybe the route of access I took. People think about it as the Greg Howe thing. I think Greg Howe got it from George Lynch. George Lynch was the first guy to do this, so much so that in Japanese guitar magazines, they had to invent the notation symbol for it. And they used, of all things, a vibrato symbol, but it was a sperm, right? Saying nothing, right? I'm saying nothing. I'm drawing no conclusions from that. It was the 1980s. It's Japanese guitar magazines. It's one of those things. So it's the George Lynch thing, but that's the slidey cliche. But it's kind of one of those fusion techniques, I guess, in so much as there is a fusion technique. I guess there isn't really. But it's one of those fusion cliches that we hear all the time, and it's important to have it in your arsenal, I guess. Anyway, let's keep on going. There's a few more. Ah, I asked this earlier. but it may have gotten lost in the chat. I didn't realize there was a Q&A at the end. Learning modes at the moment. Is it better to memorize the shapes or actually learn the note names slash numbers? These are all feeding into a bunch of questions, right? A bunch of questions. So there's this. Matt Burnett says, what's the best way of learning all these scales modes? So scales modes, it's not a monumental task. And Mike Jazz says, some techniques for fretboard visualization. Do you use intervallic functions like Tom Quayle? So, three questions that feed all into one. Learning modes, learning, how do I learn all these scales? And how do you visualize the fretboard with this stuff? So what I do, personally, I approach this from kind of like two angles. Because I'm a rock guy, and that's my bread and butter, I will often approach this stuff from a pentatonic out. So I'll take a pentatonic scale and I will extrapolate out from there. I feel like that's quite a nice way to get to grips with modes if you're coming from the perspective of being a blues or a rock guitar player. It's not for every perspective, but if that's the perspective you're coming from, quite a nice way to get used to the sound of it. However, you have to do it in context. So you can't do this just on your own and expect it to sound like anything. You have to do this against an appropriate sounding track. Otherwise, the intervals just kind of won't go in your ear, and you end up playing stuff that all just sounds like the major scale, which is a very common problem when you're learning these kind of like, bigger or some, they're not even more complicated, just these kind of like, these scales that you come to later in your guitar playing path, let's say. But in terms of fretboard visualization, yeah, I absolutely do the intervallic functions thing. Now, for those of you who don't know, the intervallic functions thing is basically the idea that you would be aware of where the root note of the chord you're playing is, and you'd be aware of all the different positions you could play that root note. So let's say we had C, we had a C here, we had a C here, we have a C here, a C here, C here, C here, etc. And from there, you know how to reach for and find every interval that you're likely to use. So let's say I was playing over a Lydian chord. Let's say I was playing over this chord, which is a major chord that implies Lydian. Don't worry too much about the spelling of it. It's C major 9, sharp 11, with no third. But even still, one of those things. You might think about this as like a Lydian type chord, or even just a C major, and you wanted to play Lydian over the top. Well, what I would do is I would think about it as playing, if I was improvising at least, I would know where my C is, and then I would know where the intervals in a Lydian scale are relative to that. So I would know how to find the second, the third, the sharp four, the fifth, the sixth, and the natural seven from any given root. So I might be able to find it here. I'm thinking about all of these, not as their individual notes, but as something relative to the tonic. So I'm thinking about C, and I'm thinking about all of these notes as how they, in terms of how they relate to the tonic of the chord I'm playing over. And this is actually something that I'll do, if I'm playing over changes, this is my approach to playing over changes, because I feel like it's a little more instant. I feel like it's nice and quick. But if I'm doing more of a rock thing, I'll turn this on and off, and I'll turn this type of thinking on and off depending upon the sound I'm going for. So if I'm going for more of that Tom kind of vibe, that Tom Quayle kind of thing, I'll start thinking in these terms. Or if I'm trying to play more intervallically, I'll think in these terms. But if I'm trying to be a rock player, I won't. And I'll think about it just as, here's a pentatonic scale extrapolated out over. And that, it really just depends upon the type of vocabulary that I'm trying to conjure. So if we take a track that might tolerate both kinds of playing, let's maybe try this. So this is gonna be a groove in C sharp minor. So what I might play, if I'm trying to be a rock player, trying to do the rock thing, I might play a pentatonic out. Trying to do more of that intervallic stuff, it's not really like super rock-tastic. think more in terms of this root note to interval type line of thinking. I just feel like it kind of gives me a bit of a sliding scale from being a rock player and doing the blues player thing, a sliding scale where I can slide that into the fusion thing, or at least as far fusion as I get. So let's get on to practicing this stuff. I'll make this the last question, because there's a few things. So Hank Stein says, what is a good tempo to run through the scales to get it into your head? And our friend Matt is also saying, like, what's the best way to learn this stuff? It's not such a monumental task. Well, okay, best thing to do with this, I think personally, is to improvise using the sound that you're trying to practice and set yourself some kind of speed constraint. So the speed constraint I would suggest is probably whatever speed that you can still think clearly at, but is fast enough to be challenging. I know that's a bit of an it depends kind of answer, but let's say I was trying to practice the sound of C sharp Aeolian, which is kind of what we're doing with this backing track. What I might do is I might improvise using some shapes that I know that correspond to C-sharp Aeolian. And I might improvise with the idea of playing just 8 notes. So maybe this. And maybe it starts with just running some scale shapes up and down. Start to make some observations about the sound of each of these notes. If I'm just blasting the thing, you know, first of all, make some mistakes, but secondly, you can't really make too many observations about the quality of each note in terms of how it relates to the thing you're playing over. So this kind of slower tempo thing, that gives you time to maybe evaluate, and you can revisit some notes and go, think about this one. Starts to develop a sense of not just the feel of the shape, but also each note and how it feels to go from one note to another. And if this gets a bit fast and you can't really keep up with it, don't be afraid to go down to slower divisions, half notes. That works. And then if you want to expand, take this a step further, start to incorporate some scale shapes, and you can find neighboring scale shapes, and just practice kind of getting in and out. It's a nice way to conquer this kind of interval scale shapes thing. What you can also do is you can set yourself the task of playing larger and smaller intervals to force you to kind of reach for things. So you can say it to yourself, I'm going to play no more than, I don't know, 5 or 6 notes in a row before I reach for a large interval. So you can play a few notes in a row, and then you got to take a chance and reach for a big old interval. That's a fun way to force yourself to visualize this stuff, so to speak. And in terms of what intervals you pick, it doesn't really matter. It's kind of up to you. But part of that is going to inform your personal vocabulary. So quite hard to talk and play while you're doing that, but you know, you get the gist of it. Actually, talking and playing is quite good because it's kind of a fun way to distract yourself from overthinking what you're playing. But anyway, yeah, so that's kind of how I'd practice this. Now, what you'll notice is that I haven't really given you any kind of recommendations as to play at this tempo or play this scale in this order, and then play it in thirds, and then play it in fourths, etc., etc. That stuff's useful, but if you're trying to develop vocabulary, what I feel is much, much more useful is to improvise and to make notes of what you like, and try and play that some more, if that makes sense. Try and play the stuff that you like more, and the stuff that you don't like, just shelve it and go, okay, I don't like that, so I'm gonna make a point to avoid that. And that's kind of how you develop your own personal vocabulary with this stuff. And for our friend Matt, it's a really important point that I want to make, is that, let me just show that here, right, real quick. I'm just going to throw this out one more time. So our friend Matt, what's the best way of learning this stuff? It's not such a monumental task. I feel like having access to a small portion of these scales and then making music with that small portion and then discovering more of the territory as you go is the way to do it. So don't feel afraid to just have one scale shape that you port around. So let's say, for example, you have one position that you know all of these scales in. That's enough to start getting to grips with the sound of the scales that you're playing. Don't feel like you have to know all of the scales in every position before you can start using them, because in reality, understanding the sound of the scales that you're trying to make and the interval content is going to speed up the process of learning that scale over the rest of the fingerboard, over the rest of the map. You might think about this as, if you've ever played a strategy game where you start on a tile, let's say, and the rest of the map is grayed out, it's in fog, right? And then you start exploring and more of the fog goes away and you see more of what's there. You don't reveal the whole map before you start building whatever it is that you're building. Let's say you're playing like Civilization or something. You don't like not build a city until you've explored the whole map. And the same is true for learning this stuff. You don't like not make music until you've learned all the scales. So if you only knew like box one position pentatonic and the derivations of that, you can really do some damage with that. And it gives you a chance to explore the sound of these scales. And what that does, which is really interesting, is once you know the sound of the scale really well, you can actually start just self-correcting. And it's almost as if your fingers know where to reach for the intervals if you're really super immersed in that sound. It's a very, very strange phenomenon. But learning extra scale shapes for scales you already know the sound of and you know the feel of is way easier. So I would say, if you have a little bit of, you know, a little bit of knowledge, work with that, make some music with it. So there you go. So there you go, guys. That's been a little bit of a look into first steps into fusion. Wow. So we've done two lessons on chord changes, but it's a pretty deep subject. I feel like we've at least cracked some of it, though. So if you guys want a bit more information on the playing over changes aspect of fusion, then we'll absolutely, you know, we'll keep these streams available on the GI YouTube channel. Make sure you watch the replay, digest it as much as you need to. Next week, we're going to talk some more and we will address some more of the stylistic elements and maybe some more of that outside type thing that you guys are probably super keen to know. Because that's one of the questions people ask as well when they say, hey, I want to play fusion. What they really mean is I want to play outside and have it sound cool. So maybe we'll address that too. But in the meantime, I'm just going to play some more. So I feel like I'm really digging that Richie Kotzen style backing track. So I may play some more on that one. These are all available on the GI YouTube channel, of course. So hey, check these tracks out. They're available for free. Available to you for free even. And if you so desire, you can check out GI Plus. I would love it if you did. It's the GI lesson platform and it's what keeps the lights on at GI Tower. So if you want to support these streams, the best way you can do so is, of course, by sharing them, giving us a thumbs up, giving us a comment and all that stuff so we can reach more guitar players, but also check out GI Plus. Maybe consider subscribing because it helps us tons and there is so much value to be had for you guys in there, especially if you're into fusion. We got so much great fusion stuff there. But for the time being, more playing. My name is Nick Jennison for GI. That's the wrong camera. This is the right camera. I'll see you guys next time. Let's do some playing. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Cobb, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.